£1 billion worth of economic benefit for our city region and enable us to get the full benefits of HS2, even if the project isn't delivered through the HS2 programme. Hot off the press, Pembroke Development here. There was a partnership board meeting yesterday in Hull with Transport for the North, and one of the papers that went forward in that partnership board was request for approval of the Northern Powerhouse Railway programme, and the work has been developed over the course of the last 3 years. This is just an extract from a presentation that's part of that report, and what it shows is that the current proposals going to Liverpool now from Transport for the North are for a new line from Liverpool connecting onto the HS2 network via Warrington to then also connect through on HS2 to Manchester Airport onto Manchester, and then utilise the Northern Powerhouse Rail to go further east. This intervention will give us what we're looking for in terms of our north-south HS2 connectivity, west-east Northern Powerhouse Rail connectivity, and create that freight capacity on existing networks. We need to drive for this now to become more than warm words and become delivery for us as a region. It's not all just about transport infrastructure in a heavy sense. Walrus and our smart ticket platform for our city region. We are delivering now significant benefits from a smart card perspective. We've got 2.3 million Walrus cards sold to date and a total value of 18 million products put onto our Walrus card. Walrus ticket sales are now at £450,000 worth a week, and we are moving now Walrus into rail and looking to expand the portfolio of Walrus as a product. Merseyrail, can't talk about rail in our city region without Merseyrail. Merseyrail concession devolved from DfT to Mersey Travel in 2003. Merseyrail Electrics were awarded the concession in 2003. Joint venture 50-50 between Serco and Abellio, and is regularly now top performing rail operator across the country on the National Transport Focus Surveys. Within that, the rolling stock programme is a key generational opportunity for us to modernise, obviously, a key element of our rail infrastructure, the rolling stock itself. So some background and an update on where we are with that. It's cornerstone of the strategy that I touched on earlier on. Stadler was selected as preferred bidder, and the CA made the decision in December of 16 to approve the project and progress forward with Stadler. The rationale for driver-controlled operation of the fleet was fully explained at that point in time and accepted through that process, and we're now in play with a £460 million programme with an added potential of over £400 million in maintenance work to take place over the next 40 years. We awarded contracts in February of this year, and it's going to give us the facility to deliver a comprehensive modernisation of not just Merseyrail's infrastructure from a fleet perspective, but also the whole operational approach on the railway. Rolling stock itself, we adopted a best practice approach for passengers in consultation with Transport Focus. The procurement process is an unusual one in the UK at the minute. Mersey Travel are buying the trains on behalf of the combined authority. They'll be in public ownership. We've got a highly innovative and bespoke product there. They'll be safer, more powerful, and with greater carrying capacity, and they'll go faster. But it's not just about the trains. There's a significant programme of work on the depots. There'll be comprehensive modernisation of Birkenhead North. There's a completely new facility that's going to be constructed at Kirkdale. And Stadler appointed Van Nuttall, a Warrington-based contractor, as their taking contractor for those works. They've been encouraged very strongly to promote a local supply chain as part of that process, as part of our responsible procurement strategy. Mobilisation work's already started. The main construction due to commence in 17, and we've programmed to complete in 19 in advance of delivery of the fleet. Maintenance aspect of it, business changes from Mersey Rail to Stadler in terms of maintenance on the 1st of October of this year. There are approximately 150 of the current Mersey Rail employees who will transfer to Stadler under TUPE, but the union consultation on that is successfully completed. And Stadler will maintain the current fleet until it goes back to 2020 and then pick up management for the fleet from there on in. All the safety management systems for the new fleet management, new fleet maintenance have been established, and there's a review underway with the Office of Rail and Road, and the new fleet will deliver a step change for us in reliability, availability and presentation. Again, infrastructure is important. We've got to spend a significant sum of money on upgrading the power supply to enable the train to operate, and we've got to do some significant work in the platform train interface to remove the gap that is a current problem for us on our station. But again, all planned to be completed in 2019 when the train's coming. It is quite a complex commercial arrangement. There's four partners involved in it commercially. There's ourselves, Merseyrail, Network Rail and Stadler. There's a bespoke set of contracts in place there, and they were all signed in February of this year. Governance practices are in place to oversee the collaborative work here, and as a consequence of the commercial aspects of the business, Stadler have now established their UK base in the Liverpool City region and Liverpool City Centre, and they're looking at the use of Birkenhead North as a competency centre and a facility for use to provide overhaul of the rest of their UK fleet. So significant inward investment opportunity as well. Budget and risk. The 460 million budget covers the physical works for the delivery of the fleet. All the budgetary control systems that you'd expect are all established and operate effectively. Governance arrangements in place to manage the budget against those budgets. Comprehensive risk registers have been established and continually being updated and developed. And there's a strong confidence that the project can be delivered on time and within budget. But we've got a problem. And I think you'd word one of the challenges there. There is also an industrial action associated with this. R&T are in dispute with Merseyrail, not with Merseytravel, but in dispute with Merseyrail over the conversion to driver controlled operation or DCO. What I can say is the relevant safety bodies, the Office of Road and Rail, the Road, Rail Safety and Standards Bureau, have both publicly confirmed that DCO is a safe method of operation on the rail network. It's the only realistic way we can respond to the findings of the RAIB report from the King Street fatality in 2011. It's worth understanding the RMT action is part of a national campaign as a consequence of issues on Southern and Northern and some other networks. You will be aware we've suffered 8 days of action to date. Some of that action has been targeted at high profile events at Grand National, the Open Golf and the Clone Show event. ASLEF aren't in dispute, but unfortunately the drivers aren't crossing RMT picket lines. But even on the dates that have been targeted, Merseyrail have been able to provide an effective skeleton service to get through those strike dates. RMT are holding that national stance and the second safety critical person on board every train. There have been meetings looking to try and find solutions through this with Metro Merseytravel, Liam. RMT have made suggestions of how they think that we could develop funding that would enable us to retain that second person. We're not able to come up with any options that are actually realistic or deliverable for us. But critically, both ourselves and Merseyrail are open to discussions with the RMT in an attempt to try and find an amicable solution to this problem. Happy to take any questions that might arise as a consequence of that presentation. Are there any questions?
The justification for adopting driver controlled operations was explained in December to us all as an effect change since then. And the awful tragedy accident of Jane Street, the RMT have stated that the introduction of driver controlled operations on Merseyrail while complying with the recommendations of the report led into the fatal accident of Jane Street is completely at odds with the requirement of basic railway safety. How would you respond to us all?
Just because I don't think many people could hear that, but if you do it again, if you put the microphone right the way down, if you bend.
Thanks, Steve and Frank, for a good presentation. I have a couple of questions, though. The justification for adopting driver controlled operations was explained in December to us all as anything changed since then. And the awful tragedy accident of Jane Street, the RMT have stated that the introduction of driver controlled operations on Merseyrail, while
some of the question and response.
Yeah, I think I got that. The two questions, isn't it? Two questions there. First one, justification was explained to the combined authority members back in December. Do we feel that anything's changed since then? And do we still consider it's the right decision? The first one, Barry? Yeah. Okay. I think the rationale for the original decision remains completely valid. Where we are since the award of the contract, touched on it in the presentation there, the Office of Railway Road has confirmed that the driver controlled operation is a safe method of operation on the UK rail network. They've also published a set of guidelines around which they consider ECO would need to be introduced and operated to enable that safe requirement to be met. Those guidelines fully align with the approach that we've adopted for the development of the new fleet on Mersey Rail. And we've also had a presentation with the ORR in May of this year, where we've taken them through everything that we've done and everything that we're proposing. And there are no issues expressed from that presentation by ORR. Also, touched on in the presentation, the Rail Safety and Standards Board, since we made the decision, have published a considerable body of evidence in relation to driver control operation on the network. And that evidence looks at historical data, trends, and how things have progressed. And they've concluded that, if anything, driver control operation is safer than conventional operation on the network. I think also critical within that, we highlighted the need for the platform train interface work. When we did the survey work with the Transport Focus, the key point that was raised by our customers was they wanted the issue of getting on and off the trains addressed, so that behind the gap announcements, that was their concern. With the introduction of the slide step and platform train modifications, we've made it the most accessible network, or it will be the most accessible heavy rail network in the UK when we introduce the new fleet. So I think, coming back to the original question, from my perspective, if I was standing here in front of you today, I would make exactly the same recommendation that was made back in December of 2016. So I don't think that justification has changed. It's actually got stronger.
Councillor O'Bear?
There's a second one, I think. And I think the second one related more to the specifics of James Street. Again, touched on it slightly in the early answer. There was a report undertaken, obviously, as a consequence of that fatality, and that report made recommendations. And a couple of the recommendations that it made is that we had to reduce the risk of train dispatch, and they suggested a number of ways in which that could be done. One of them is that the person who was responsible for controlling the movement and the braking of the train needed to be able to observe that platform train interface as the train was leaving the platform. And that's a very critical aspect, something that needs to be undertaken. And that also that same person was able to stop the train directly in the event of an emergency. And driver controlled operation is the optimal way of addressing that particular issue. And what we did as part of the tendering process, we included the RAIB's report in the tender documents to each of the bidders. And there was a requirement in those documents that they comply with those requirements as part of their bid. All the bidders proposed driver controlled operation as their approach. So I think we've addressed that concern and issue, but I think critically failing to address those recommendations would put us at very significant risk of not having the fleet approved by the ORR when we submit for review.
Sorry, Barry, does that answer both parts of the question that you posed? Apologies. Councillor Gray.
Thanks, Chair. If I can indulge by both on my part of that, Councillor Montalbán, who's a real estate chair user, but also an expert in the built environment and has been really instrumental in what's going to be the most accessible service when this comes online, I think. She's done a tremendous way. For those that don't know, can you just explain to us the relationship between Mersey Rail and Mersey Travel? Because because both often get confused, when especially when the public hear these messages, they don't know which one they're available to.
Okay, that's a very good point. A lot of the rail franchises, as they are in most areas across the country, they're held by the Department for Transport, and the Department for Transport is the franchise awarding body. So for Southern and Northern and Greater Anglia, I could go on forever, Council of Ireland, DfT are the awarding entity. In 2002, Mersey Travel secured the responsibility for the Mersey Rail Network. It became a devolved rail network for Merseyside as it was at the time, and Mersey Travel took up the responsibility of being the franchise awarding body and the franchise managing body for the Mersey Rail Network. It's a concession for us here rather than the franchise in other places. So we're effectively the client, and since the government's changed, we've got the client on behalf of the combined authority. We're effectively the client. Mersey Rail are effectively the contractor. So they have a 25-year concession to operate the network on behalf of Mersey Travel. In 2028, we will, in advance of 2028, but so that we're ready for 2028, we will have gone out to tender to the next concession, and it may well be the same organisation, it may well be a completely different organisation. The consistent bit is we will be the client, and critically as part of that, we're also then the operator of last resort on our network. And what that means is that if there is an issue with the incumbent officer, we have to step up and take responsibility for the operation and maintenance of the Mersey Rail network.
So, sorry, I've got a few questions, if that's all right. So just to get clarity on that. So when you and the Capture Mayor met with RMT to discuss the concerns that they've got, what were their concerns and what were your solutions to those concerns?
Their primary concern is about the retention of guard control over the dispatch. Good control of the doors and dispatch of the trains, and retaining a second safety critical person on every train. Our view in that regard, linked into the RAIB investigation and linked into what happens on the rest of a significant portion of the rail network in the UK, there are instances where conventional control of doors and dispatch of trains is appropriate. But there are differences across networks, and I think that's being missed in some of the issues at the minute. Not all rail networks are the same. What we've looked at doing is focused on the right solution for the Mersey Rail network. So the RMT are concerned about door control and dispatch. 60 to 70% of rail journeys undertaken in the UK are on trains that operate in driver controlled only operation, and they are facilities like London Underground, Manchester Metro Link, Glasgow Underground, and the North East network that Nexus operate. And the difference between them is they're all inter-urban or intra-urban networks. They operate within an area, and they're all controlled and managed by the bodies responsible for those areas, so by TfL, by TfGM, and Greater Manchester Combined Authority, by SPT in Glasgow, and by Nexus up in the North East. So the locally controlled networks operate locally, shorter journey distances between stations, and completely different to an intercity facility. So we are not like Northern, we're not like Southern, we're not like longer distance networks where you can have 25, 30 minutes between stations. Our average station to station time is 3 minutes. So we've looked at a solution that suits our requirements, where I think the RMT are trying to apply a national approach, and it's not appropriate for our city meters. So they wanted to keep control of the doors and dispatch of the trains. We feel that's contrary to the RAIB recommendations and not appropriate for us. And then the other one is the second safety critical person on every train. The business case doesn't allow us to deliver on that, but in any case, we don't think it would be an appropriate approach to the operation of our network. We have had discussions with them and with Merseyside Rail where there is an offer of every train after 8 p.m. at night to have a second person on. And when you look at how our network operates, as a consequence of the guard having to be in the rear cab for the vast majority of the time, they spend very little time in the saloon with the passengers. By introducing the dedicated onboard customer support staff and with the cleaning staff, the revenue protection staff, British Transport Police staff, when we introduce the new fleet, there will actually be a greater presence of staff in the saloon of the train able to attend to the needs of the customer than we currently are in the way that the trains are operating now. So they're their two main points. We actually think the proposals and the design of the train, the way we've opened the carriages up, we've removed the doors, we've significantly enhanced the CCTV, it's a completely different train that requires a different approach to operation.
I understand that, but Orient is very clear on that they believe that Merseyrail are putting safety over profits. So, and I had a suggestion that the shareholders of Merseyrail, obviously travel, that's why I'm saying it's a bit of confusion, and should actually be looking at this to find ways to fund it. Have we approached Merseyrail, and what was the outcome of that?
We've spoken to Merseyrail about the RMT's request. Merseyrail competed for this in a competitive tender scenario. It's a contractual arrangement that we can't force Merseyrail to change. But one of the key points that we made to the RMT, even were Merseyrail to be prepared to accept that they pick up the cost of the second person on the train, that would only get us to 2028. When the existing concession ends, we would still have the problem from 2028 for the other 28 years for the remaining life of the fleet, that we wouldn't have the funding available to be able to provide that second person on a train. So we can't make Merseyrail do it, or even if they were prepared to do it, we would still have that hangover in 2028.
Finally, Jane, so I mean, obviously, we're all ready to say as well the loss of staff. So, what have we done to look at the loss of staff on the trains as well as the staff that staff our stations? You know, I mean, most of our stations are staff that I'm aware of, especially in Liverpool. So, I mean, what will be the consequences?
Okay. Touching on the station bit first, I should have referenced that earlier because that's another major reason why we're not the same as Southern or Northern or other networks. As a requirement under the concession agreement, every Merseyrail station is staffed from first train to last train. So not only are we only 3 minutes from station to station, at each station there is a member of staff, which is not the norm on the rest of the rail network. And again, that's one of the reasons why we made the decision we've taken. There is always a presence at a station that can help and assist. The design of the trains with the sliding step and the modifications to the platform mean that there will be the facility for unaided access, and Drive Councillor Thomas has been incredibly helpful in the development approach to the network. But we won't have the accessibility issues that we have in other areas that can be dealt with and that can be addressed on our network. In relation to the trains themselves, we're entirely comfortable with the after 8 p.m. offer and with the design of the train. Antisocial behaviour will be limited and we'll be able to manage that. But coming back to the staff and the protection of the staff, as part of the decision that the CA took, there was a guarantee of continued employment to all the staff that were employed as guards at that point in time. And what that means is nobody will be forced to leave Merseyrail's employ against their will. They also have lifetime protection on their terms and conditions of employment. So even as a consequence of a reduction on-train staff, if they are redeployed, they will be redeployed on their existing terms and conditions of employment. So no one will be forced to leave against their will, no one will suffer a financial detriment, and none of this will have any impact for the next 3 years until we bring the trains onto the network.
Sorry, Jim, but will we have a dialogue about it?
My door, as you know, was always open. We met on a number of occasions, and at the last meeting, did say, even though it had ended with no real progress on our side, did say that we would be happy at any future date to meet again to see where we push things forward. We're desperate to try and get some progress on this. Everybody knows what the current situation is. You're absolutely right. There's a lot of confusion out there, and at least with some of the questions from before. Hopefully, some of those confusions may well have been rectified or clarified. Actually, those two questions, Councillor Davis.
It was just a follow-up question about funding for the second safety critical person on every train, hopefully. So, are there any suggestions being made as to where that funding will come from and how realistic?
First, I think we need to say that the current business case doesn't allow for it, so we could not fund it through the existing business case arrangements. There have been a number of suggestions that have come from the RMT in discussions that we've had with them. One was public affairs to facilitate the return of the second person on the train. The level at which we'd have to put affairs up to be able to do that would be such that it would damage the John network, the passengers would decline, numbers would decline, and even if we were to put fares up by 5.5% over RPI, which is our normal, there would still be a very significant financial shortfall. So putting fares up isn't a realistic option, and it's something that when we presented it to yourselves and you made the decision, we said would not need to be done to deliver the new fleet. That's one option. Second one was asking about the potential to de-staff the stations. Again, in de-staffing the stations, we still would not be able to deliver the savings necessary to retain a second person on every train because station staff are paid the same as the train staff are paid. And again, the station staff are critically important in our network, and a lot of people will have a view that the member of staff at the station is more important than the member of staff on the train. So they've raised that one. They've also asked about whether the CA would borrow more to be able to fund the retention of a second person on every train. And the issue with that is that the cost per year is between 5 and 7 million. Over the lifetime of the fleet, that equates to over 200 million in total cost. There is no way that we'd be able to repay that money, but even where we can't borrow money for revenue, we can't borrow money for staff. So again, that one is undeliverable. They asked about could we extend the Merseyrail concession by a further 5 years, ask Merseyrail to reduce their profit level, and then use that reduction to fund the guards. Again, we can't get that to stack up financially, but we would also then again have the problem that in 2028, when we tender for a new concession, that would no longer be available to us to support the second person on the train. So it would still leave us with a significant challenge coming the new concession in 2028. So we have looked at a whole series of options. They've raised options. We've assessed those options, but we've had to go back and say, we cannot deliver what you're asking for in a financially acceptable way. But I think wrapped up around all of that, there's another critical one. For £5 million to £7 million a year, and for £200 million over the life of the trains, the view that we have is we actually don't need them to operate the trains safely and effectively. There would be an awful lot of better uses that we could put that money to in a public sector environment than to retain a person that we actually don't think is necessary on the train.
Okay, I'm going to conclude this one now. Just two quick points. Obviously, quite rightly, Councillor O'Brien talked about Councillor Thompson's work. I think that we should identify and that way refer to stuff on disability rights, but also on accessibility, access rights to people with disabilities in the North of Ireland. Just one that hasn't been touched on, which is I was with Liam in the House of Commons for the launch of the Walrus card. Is there anybody present who thinks that Walrus is an appropriate name for our ticketing system? I think we need to look at that. It might be something that we bring to a future meeting to relaunch and rebrand what I think is not the ideal image of what we're trying to convey, a big globally slowed animal rather than something a bit more nimble, which is what we hopefully convey. Thanks very much for that presentation, Frank. We're going on to item 8. It's one of the elements of the devolution deal. I think people will be aware of this, but we work with the government to develop a business case for an innovative approach to help people into work. And this report seeks approval to accept government funding, so it might go through, but a programme to support households into work, which will be piloted in the Liverpool City region. Sue Jarvis is going to take us through that.
Thanks, Chair. The report provides the background to this funding award, and it really sets out the scale of the challenge being faced in the city region, where we have 100,000 residents in receipt of sickness benefits, which is the highest rate of any economic area nationally. In this context, there's a recognition that despite the best efforts of service providers over many years, the existing delivery system has failed to produce the step change that the city region needs. However, with this innovative pilot, we have the opportunity to test out an alternative service delivery model, which is designed to improve the economic prospects of households where more than one adult is unemployed and receives benefits. The programme will test new ways of working by integrating a new role of employment advocate across the councils and within local housing and health delivery systems. The intention is to work with a number of a minimum of 800 households across the city region over a two-year period. And by adopting an action learning approach, this programme will also contribute to the wider public sector reform agenda that we have. Can I refer members to the report's recommendations, which are on page 49.
Yeah. Are there any questions, Sue? Councillor Ben?
Sorry, Chair, it's not really a question, it's a political statement. It's that whilst the government's getting the money, the other we've got a feed and a massive campaign about the closure of jobs and businesses across the region and just the hypocrisy of this government. We have offered them in Liverpool accommodation that's actually greater than what they've currently got. And they are still willing to do this despite ministers saying that they would look at it favourably. So it's one hand giving and one hand taking away. And also the fact that the government will be introducing the only claim for benefits online and the changes to underpaid for accommodation and older people. So that if, for example, you are in a relationship with somebody where it used to be if one person reached 65, they would all be entitled to benefits and didn't have to pay. If one person is 65, the other person has to wait to reach their benefits. So you could have, for example, women 63 having to go online to look for jobs and to claim benefits, and the accessibility of people, you know, especially if they are older, to have access to the internet isn't always there. So whilst this is, of course, good that this is coming forward, we also need to recognise that it's as well as they are reducing the accessibility of some of our poorest residents, and it really is just shameful in this moment.
Any further questions? I think the problem with Charles, I'd say, is that it's a confused picture of the government. Can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 49? Item 9 is, again, Sue going to take us through a short presentation that sets out the initial findings of the city region's employer skills survey. Sorry.
Before I actually run through the findings of the survey, what I wanted to do just very briefly was provide a wider context of the labour market in terms of the context of the environment the survey actually took place in. Just to say, there's been some significant recent jobs growth in the city region, which has been similar to the northwest, but lower than the national rate. One interesting finding is that the types of jobs that we have in the city region have become more highly skilled over the last 10 years, and what we have now are level 4 occupations, which is degree level or above, now account for 28% of the workforce, which is actually 50% more than it was a decade ago. We have been narrowing the gap in terms of the proportion of residents with higher level qualifications compared to other parts of the country, but we still have those residents with no qualifications above the average. If we look in terms of future job growth, what we need to also be mindful of is the impact of replacement demand within our businesses. This will increase the number of job openings, but it will also mean we have to replace experience, which in itself will be a challenge. As a city region, we are a relatively self-contained labour market, and we have quite low levels of in-commuting and of migrant labour. We also have a lower level of population growth than many other city regions, and higher rates of inactivity, which I've just mentioned in the previous item, which means we have a tightening of the labour market itself, which means it makes the situation more difficult. So moving on to the survey, this employer skills survey is actually one of the largest and most comprehensive sub-regional surveys in the country. And we've actually achieved our target of interviewing 1,800 businesses across the city region, which gives us a real rich data set to interrogate. The questions that were included in the survey will give some important information that will help inform local economic growth. And we asked quite a lot about skill needs, skill gaps, and what the impact of that is on our business. It also builds on national research and national questions, so we'll be able to benchmark the city region with other areas of the country. Today I'm just going to skip over some of the initial findings, but what we're in the process of doing through the consultants is doing some further analysis, and we'll get a real rich overview of some of the key issues. This is important because this information will be used to underpin the work we're doing in the evidence base as part of the devolution of the adult education budget, which is in the region of £34 million in the city region. In terms of the employers, we've had a broad range of responses from the employers across a whole range of sectors of different sizes and across the city region as a whole. What it equates to probably is about 1 in 7 city region businesses that are employing over 5 people. They've participated in the survey, which is around about 40%. We asked some questions about the nature of the businesses, and 10% have said they've got a primary market outside of the UK. 44% of the businesses surveyed had a primarily a local market. In terms of some of the key messages that are starting to come through, we found that 2/3 of the employers who've been surveyed and recruited during the last 12 months, and that was about 4,000 job opportunities. Around half of these were to replace either an employee leaving their firm, and a third were due to business growth. Whilst 3 in 5 of the employers reported no problems in undertaking their recruitment, the city region does have more hard-to-fill vacancies than is typically the case. We've got 41% of our vacancies are hard-to-fill, whereas nationally that figure is 23%. And what we've also found is that some of the vacancies cut across a number of occupational areas and sectors. So, for example, you've got engineers or electricians being required in advanced manufacturing, but they're also being required in sectors such as construction. So it makes it more of a complex piece. We also found that employers are reporting a larger workforce skills gap than nationally, and this is mainly around specific technical skills and general employability skills when they were asked to expand on that. When recruiting, our employers have said that job applicants are better prepared for work than nationally, so that's a positive, very much so. not surprisingly, when people are not prepared for work, this is more prevalent among the long-term unemployed and the new entrants to the workforce. So again, that will give us some pointers in terms of how we play that back into service provision. Generally, workforce training is occurring across many of the businesses that we talk to, but with limited budgets, many said that they were delivering training in-house. And there was a broader view that's come through the analysis that very much we have a low wage economy and employers are choosing not to increase wage rates to improve their staff retention. I've just got a couple of slides that I'm just going to move on to now to just give you a bit of a flavour of how we can actually drill down into some of this analysis. We'll be able to do some quite detailed sectoral analysis and geographical analysis across all of the local authority areas. But if we take a look at health and social work, which is the largest single employment sector in the city region, we've got in the region of 180,000 people employed in this sector, and that represents about 18% of all employees. 81% of businesses who were interviewed said they had vacancies in the last 12 months, and 41% of these were hard to fill vacancies compared to the 23% as I mentioned earlier in the UK. When asked what the particular shortages were, these tended to be in nursing and care. Asking the question, what's the main reason for the hard to fill vacancies? For health and social work, this tended to be low numbers of applicants with the correct skills, or low numbers of applicants more generally. We then asked, well, what are the skills that are lacking? And 38% of the businesses responding said this was general employability and work readiness. And that was above the survey-wide average. Another example here is information technology, and this sector's on the slides because it was the sector with the highest levels of technical skills gaps that was recorded in the survey. And whilst we've got a similar proportion of vacancies and hard to fill vacancies as in health and social work, when asked for the main reason not filling vacancies, this sector was saying, well, there's not enough people interested in doing this type of job. So again, it's an important message there in terms of some of the careers materials and some of the messages we want to get out to people about the opportunities in the IT sector. When asked which skills are lacking, 71% cited technical skills specific to the sector. This was things such as Java development, particular shortages linked to network management. So we've got some quite detailed analysis about the types and nature of the skill gaps that we've got. In terms of the impact of how to build vacancies in this sector, the most common response to this was, well, it's actually going to have a delay in developing new products and services. So again, this has an impact on the wider innovation and growth of businesses in the area. Moving on, just finally to training. We asked employers a whole range of questions about training. And whilst it was good that workforce training was commonplace across the area, with 83% of businesses saying that they did undertake some training for their staff, 43% of businesses said that they didn't have a budget for this,